transforming an interior render from this to this is not as hard as you think. There are just a few key principles to focus on, and they work no matter which render engine you're using. So this video will definitely enhance your architectural visualization skills. For these examples, I'll be working in D5 render, but if you're in another software, you can easily adapt the steps. Great results don't come from the engine itself, though that counts, but mainly from knowing the core principles. And I'll break this down into five clear steps you need to keep in mind. We're going to be using this 3D model here, which is a renovation project, and you can download it for free in the link in the video description. This workflow here applies to any type of interior visualization, and honestly, for exteriors too, though exteriors, they have a few extra details to consider. This video is proudly sponsored by Real World Textures, and I'll be talking more about them and how you can get high quality materials for your render engine later in the video. It's a vital step for any realistic architectural visualization. And lastly, I've added timestamps in case you want to skip ahead or go back to specific parts of the process. So now, let's get started. First things first, the base 3D model. And this is not necessarily a core principle, but still a big part of your final result depends on its quality. And again, it doesn't matter which 3D software you're using, SketchUp, Rhino, ArchiCAD, Revit, Blender, whatever you prefer for your architectural design process. The key here is to add complexity and detail. If you're aiming for realism, your model shouldn't just be a plain white box. So try bringing real elements into it. And there are many things I could use as an example here, but take this one. When two materials meet, in some situations, it's important to actually model a small gap between them. This spacing creates a shadow that makes the render feel more believable. Also, think about curved surfaces. This shelving system, for instance, has a rounded edge, and modeling it properly will make a big difference in how it will look in the render. Same thing for rounded edges, because super sharp edges are often unrealistic. So either model it inside your 3D model with actual geometry, or then rely on a round edge setting inside the render engine when available. Again, these are just details, but they add up and they help you get a nicer final result. Just note that your 3D file needs to have a coherent level of detail across, so avoid contrast of details. In my case here, since this is a renovation project, it also made sense to model existing elements like this exposed pipe here. And as I'm navigating through the 3D model, notice how all of my surfaces are color-coded, right? For more ArcVis-focused models, I like to organize myself like this. Instead of adding the textures here in 3D, I'm just saying this. I mean, this is personal preferences, but just so you don't find it weird that it's all randomly colored. And we'll get to materials in just a moment, but first, let's talk about lighting. The order of the steps doesn't really matter, but it's a good idea to set up at least a base lighting early so that you can preview everything in the file correctly. Lighting is one of the most important parts of an interior render. And the mood you want to create will guide your choices, but your windows are usually the main source of light. I have a single material applied to everything to show you this part of the lighting, and some engines allow you to switch on the material override to have a clay render look, so take advantage of that. And now, a common trick in the CGI industry that I'm not sure if you heard about it, but I use it very often and it makes a lot of difference, is to add rectangular lights on windows roughly the same size of the openings to boost the exposure inside. And this light here is really subtle. It's just there to complement the main source, not really replace it. I usually keep the values low. And again, this works for any render engine I'm showing you here in D5, but the principle applies everywhere. And here's with the rectangular lights, and here's without it. See the difference? Sometimes I'll even place a rectangular light behind the camera if the scene feels too dark. But in this case here, I'll even use smaller values, like something between 1 and 5, with a neutral color temperature. As reference, a natural daylight is about 5,600 Kelvin, but you should always test and adjust. This needs here to be almost imperceptible, but only enough so that you avoid those super shadowy parts if the window itself is not enough to light up the scene. But also, interior spaces will always have artificial lights, right? So try bringing them here, even if they are not really totally defined in the project yet. So there's really no escape here. If you don't have large windows to bring in natural light, you will have to use the extra rectangular light trick, or have to rely on artificial light, or even both sometimes, or else your images will be too dark, even lacking purpose. And if your project allows, something I like to do from time to time is also to experiment with moodier setup, like a dawn scene with a cool blue light coming from outside and warm lights turned on inside. that contrast can give you some really cool and strong results. This night scene uses a bluish HDRI, but also the rectangle window trick with the blue soft light coming in. Even softer in this case, so value even lower. And I'm going more in-depth on lighting because it was one of the most requested topics from a question box I opened on Instagram about this video. So go follow us at Learn Upstairs to get all of the insights on future videos. And as a last tip here on lighting, use emissive materials with an actual light source when needed. That way you can get a better look by combining the glow and bloom effect from the emissive with an actual light source lighting up the space. And you can do that with spotlights, rectangular lights, or even disc lights. Now let's move on and talk about materials. This one is obvious, right? Materials are essential for any architectural visualization. But here's the thing, it's not just about the texture itself. It's a little bit more than that, and I'm gonna try to keep this simple because honestly, I could spend a whole full hour just talking about this, but just a few minutes, I'll make you understand this. So besides the base texture, which sometimes are called base color map or diffuse, you also need the maps that tell your render engine what type of surface you're working with. For example, normals, that blue and purple image, simulate the surface of relief. They help the engine calculate how shadow fall on the texture, which creates this illusion of depth. Specular or reflection maps are sometimes included to show how reflective a surface is, though newer workflows often skip them. I mean, the specular slider is still useful and still works, but sometimes without maps. You will then get a roughness map, which controls how shiny or matte the material looks. Keep in mind that glossiness is a map that can come instead, and it's just the inverse of roughness, so you can either flip it in Photoshop using the inverse tool, or then invert directly in your render engine if you have that option. There's a displacement map, there's a metalness map, which is sometimes needed, an ambient occlusion map, which is sometimes useful. I mean, the list goes on here, but the essentials are these ones here. And in combination, all of these maps, plus then a few others that I just mentioned that sometimes are needed, create a realistic material. I know this can sound complicated, but you don't need to get too technical to set up materials. The key is to have a good material library that already includes all of these maps. Built-in libraries in engines like D5, Lumion, or Twinmotion are fine for a start, but for interior scenes especially, you will want more realistic options and more variety to show your clients how the space will look. And that's where the sponsor of this video comes in. Real World Textures is a massive library of, as the name says, real materials. The big difference here is that they partner with manufacturers to scan actual products. So when you apply a fabric, flooring, or finish in your render, your client can actually buy that same material in real life. Instead of hunting down for similar options later, you're already specifying something that exists. Their team focuses on digitization at scale, turning real-world catalogs into digital assets you can use directly in your projects. So what you're working with in your 3D space isn't just a generic texture, it's a digitized version of the real product. And what you're seeing here is what you can achieve with their materials. Obviously, it depends on the render engine you're using. If you're working with Corona, where you can push the material settings to the max with displacements and advanced maps, this is the type of quality the library can deliver. But it also works for simpler engines like Lumion, Twinmotion, Enscape, or D5, still giving you impressive quality and plenty of options to choose from. They even let you request materials directly on their website. Using a state-of-the-art flatbed scanner with a large scanning area, they capture both color and surface structure with a complete accuracy. So the collection will only keep growing as more architects and designers use it. Honestly, I highly recommend checking them out. I'll leave a link in the video description. And the first 300 people who use my code LEARNUPSTAIRS10 will get 10% off on any subscription. And once you add a material to your account, it's yours forever. Also, they offer a free section on their website, so even if you're not ready or really don't want to invest in a premium library, you can still download free materials and start building your personal collection. Most of the materials you see here in this 3D are from Real World Textures, higher quality and more variety than a built-in library, but still extremely easy to use and implement into a typical visualization for architecture. All right, next up, assets. And here we're talking about two things, furniture, which most students and architects already think about it and do this properly, but also decoration, the little details that bring life to a space. This is a real game changer if you want impactful results. And the key to assets is to think about how things behave in the real world, like chairs aren't perfectly aligned or spaced evenly. Also, shelves shouldn't be completely empty. I mean, you don't have to overload them like I did here, but at least a few objects, like how would it be used in the day to day, you know? Even small details, like in my case here, again, since it's a renovation, an electrical cord slightly off center makes a difference, you know? It's a layer of storytelling. It's a higher reason for this image to exist in a sense. Maybe it's a book or it's an object on a coffee table or even the moka pot on the stove. See where I'm going with this? It all adds to an extra realism on your visualizations. It's not always about the most realistic settings, but how you tell this story. And remember, you don't need to model everything yourself. In fact, you shouldn't. Use asset libraries. That's what all major artists and architects do. SketchUp's 3D warehouse has a huge selection, but since it's not curated, you'll spend more time filtering through the options. If you have the budget, I'm telling you, premium libraries that are made for architects are so worth it. For example, this chair I used is from Real World. I mean, it's from the free ones, but it gets the same quality from the paid one as well. Or even this couch here. I mean, the modeling quality is amazing. Real World is still growing its asset collection, but what's great about their whole concept, again, here with the models, is that every digital model they release is based on a real product you can actually buy. So if your client likes a specific chair in the render, it exists in the real world. Also, it's super useful that their models come in multiple formats. Often the FBX file is the one that's going to work across different engines, and it's also the FBX file that comes set up with texture maps. It's simply downloading and placing it, and some small adjustments if needed. And if you like plugins, they have those too for some specific workflows. And even though they're sponsoring this video, I can honestly say that they've built an amazing solution for architects and visualization professionals. Check out the link in the video description. You will find some free assets there too, so you can test it right away. Now, doing lighting, material, and assets is pointless if you can't frame your project correctly. That's why number four is scenes. How you frame your digital space has a huge impact on the final image or video, and I can't tell you how many times I've seen renders that could have been so much stronger with just a better camera position. And honestly, you don't need to reinvent the wheel here. Often a one vanishing point for interior shots is the way to go. Let the camera angle sort of go unnoticed so that the space speaks louder. For interior spaces, you might want to try a lower camera angle. So if your 3D or render engine has the option, I like to change the walk and set something like a 1.2 tall camera height, or even lower sometimes. Architectural photographers use the same trick because it makes the viewer feel more connected to the space. Also, play with the focal length, but try to think about how you would do this in the real world. If you were a photographer and you could pick real lenses to take this photo, would you go extra wide and distort the space like 18 millimeters? Or would you try a more natural lens like a 35 millimeters or even a 50 millimeters if it fits? Remember that the human vision is closest to 50 millimeters. That's why it feels more familiar. For tight spaces, I might recommend going as low as maybe 20 millimeters. Ideally, as go as 24 millimeters max. But 35 is my go-to for most situations. Unless there's a long corridor, and then I try to go for 40 or 50 millimeters so that it doesn't feel too long of a hallway. And for extra tight spaces like a bathroom, for example, you might want to go for maybe an unrealistic camera position, like clipping the wall and looking from the side. Most engines provide this option, have an option to do this. Just be careful with the framing so that the viewer can understand where you're looking from this space, and this is actually an unrealistic point of view, sort of like a diagram in a sense. Also, always use two-point perspective option, especially when we were talking about interior spaces. Straight verticals will make your image way easier to read. And as a last tip here, think about where these scenes are going to be displayed. I know that we're used to crafting scenes horizontally. It's usually more natural to us, but chances are you're going to be sharing this on Instagram or sending this over WhatsApp. So why not explore square, you know, the 1:1 aspect ratio, or even the 4:5 Instagram format, or even like something much taller to be viewed vertically on your phone. You know, this is the 9:16 aspect ratio for an Instagram stories, for example, or even the opposite, spaces that fit into a wider aspect ratio, like this 2:1 here. What I'm saying here is that be willing to explore how you format your visuals. Now, interior images are no exception when it comes to post-production. If you've been following the channel for a while, you know how strongly I believe in using Photoshop or maybe a similar tool to add your own touch. This is where you can really push the image further and make it come to life. With AI enhancers now available, the trick is to combine them with your base render using masks in Photoshop. That way, you're fully in control of what's being enhanced and what's being revealed. Just simply dropping the AI result on top of it is just a lazy move and usually ruins the composition instead of improving. Like, you lose the materials, specifications, or details that are vital to communicate in an architectural image. It's also in a post-production where you can make human scales go from this to this, properly placed, enhanced, and even added motion blur if needed. I mean, I'm always on the side that a little motion blur is needed for realism. Or even then, the most important move that I find in a post-production is to use a camera raw filter to dial every pixel of your image. This step is non-negotiable for me. And I could talk about many things here. I could go on for hours about post-production, to be honest. And I actually do in my D5 Render Visualizing Architecture course. It's a complete course that takes you from the basics to advanced rendering techniques using D5 Render, Photoshop, and a bit of AI. It includes a full module on post-production so that you can really take control over this process. I'll leave a link in the video description in case you'd like to learn more about it. So there you go, 5 essential steps for creating interior renderings, from this to this and all of these other possible results. No matter which engine you're using, lighting, materials, assets, scenes, and post-production are the 5 things you need to get a handle on when doing interior scenes. Make sure to check out real-world textures for high-quality PBR materials and assets that fit into different workflows. Huge thanks to RealWorld for sponsoring this video and supporting our work here at Upstairs. And if you learned something new today, don't forget to subscribe so that you don't miss future tutorials. I'm pretty sure you're going to be enjoying this video right here, so click it to watch it, and I'll see you guys in the next one.